Welcome to this edition of Grassroots Civil Defense. We're going to talk about two things. We're going to talk about it in reverse order. The second thing we're going to talk about today is actually the 1957 pattern Swiss bayonet. It's got several different names. We'll get to that in a minute. It's beautiful, it's stainless steel, and it's a true dagger. First thing I want to talk about, though, is what is grassroots civil defense? Some people can't seem to wrap their head around it even after 47 YouTubes, books, and videos are out there. Grassroots civil defense is, simply put, a renovation of what our grandparents exuded during World War II, thereafter, and before. That pioneer, can-do, get-it-done, self-reliant attitude that our country seems so lacking in right now. I don't know about you, I don't want to get into politics, but I don't look up above to any of my so-called leaders for any kind of guidance. I think that it's the grassroots level, the you and me, the United States, the us in the United States, that makes our country great. It's up to you and I, shoulder to shoulder, door to door, to make this country as great as it was coming out of World War II. Now, I don't want to hear any belly aching. I'm not interested in race, religion, politics. I'm not interested in any kind of anti-government, anti-anything. Everything that grassroots civil defense does is proactive and positive. I want to help the military by being ready to fight here on my own ground. I want to be able to help medical personnel in a civil defense scenario by having basic medical training. I would like to help my neighbor if they fall down and need help. Wouldn't you like to be able to do the same thing? Let's take it a step farther. Our country, bunch of fat people, and I don't want to hear excuses. If you're out of shape, it's time to start getting into shape and quit the belly aching. Now, you and I both know that eating Twinkies and pizza and sucking down a 44-ounce Big Gulp isn't going to make you skinny. One of the reasons we put together Grassroots Civil Defense is an educational program, both video and book content. We're going to teach you how to grow your own food, like your grandparents did. It's not weird to grow your own food. It's weird not to grow your own food. You're becoming more self-reliant. But it's not a gardening video on how to prune tomatoes and how to prune roses. Okay, there's plenty of free TV shows that teach you that. What's more important to me is that next time you go to the grocery store or grow your own fruits and vegetables, that you look at it and decide what tool, what health or medical benefit, what additional uses does this produce have for my body. I want you to look at it, food as fuel and tools. I'm going to do the same thing with the spice rack and Spice and Herbal Apothecary. Wars were fought over spices, and now they've been diminished and relegated to sitting in a jar on your shelf, and you probably don't even know what to do with it. You'll be shocked and surprised when you see the health and medical benefits of using more spices with all the foods that you eat and just making teas out of it. Now, of course, we need to get into your natural surroundings as well. If you're trying to get in shape, you're trying to lose weight, you don't have to go to the gym, you don't have to buy all the fancy exercise equipment. You need to get in your car or get on a bicycle, go out in the woods and start walking. Walking's free, walking is natural, walking is low impact. And if you're walking, wouldn't it be cool to do what we've already talked about? Look at all the plants around you and know what's edible, what's medicinal, how do I use it, how do my grandparents and pioneer ancestors utilize the land as tools, becoming more self-reliant. The pioneer hybrid can-do attitude. Seems that we're sort of losing a little bit of that, doesn't it? So we're going to talk about hiking. We're going to talk about wild plants. We're going to talk about herbs. When we get into herbs, we're going to talk about medicinal herbs. Western medicine is great. Western medicine isn't used all the way around the world. In fact, herbal medications, naturopathic, homeopathic medications are more prevalent around the world than Western medicine is. I'm not saying it should be replaced. I'm saying that wouldn't it be cool? Wouldn't you be a stronger populace? Wouldn't you be better able to civilly defend yourself, your neighbors, your community, and your country, and lend medical personnel, military personnel, first responders a hand by being able to take care of some of the medical issues that might pop up in a civilian defense scenario from the knowledge that you learn through us? Now, of course, part of this education must become martial arts. Now, that doesn't mean I'm going to get into a ring and start fighting other people. If you want to, that's awesome. You should experience it. It also doesn't mean that I'm going to wear a gi and start bowing to foreign flags from other countries. There's a time and a place for that. This is not that time and place. We're going to study several different martial arts. We're going to study the field expedient, the raw, the true part of that martial arts that is effective both offensively and defensively. And because we're studying martial arts, which is martial force, for the common man, We're going to include knives and guns and sticks, okay? This isn't for little kids. We're not doing katas and we're not doing two-point sparring. This is for the big boys and for the big girls. A country that at the grassroots level is unable to defend itself is a country that is doomed to fail. And if you don't believe that, start looking at history. Take a look at our founding fathers. They were all pretty rough. They're into fencing, wrestling, boxing, and they packed muskets. So now let's get on to the second part of our little presentation here. Some people call this a Swiss Army knife. Some people call this the Model 1957 pattern Swiss bayonet knife. Some people call this the M1957 SIG Arms military Swiss Army knife. Whatever, it has about 20 different names. I call this cheap, dependable, and usable, and something you might want to take a look at for your civil defense needs. On one side, you'll see a, well, basically a six-digit serial number. The Swiss label or account for everything in their military. So this was probably a Swiss reservist blade because it's not sharpened. That doesn't mean you can't sharpen it. You'll either see a V for Victorinox on one side or you'll see a W for Wegener. Now there's another marking that you might see as well that makes it a little more special bayonet. Now if you flip it over, you'll also see another Ricasa. It's a basically, it's an F, it's a W, and it's a plus. The plus stands for Switzerland. Now, this is a stainless steel knife, and what's interesting about it is I can't figure out what the actual material of the blade is. I called and wrote two different companies trying to find out. All the people that knew have since retired. This has been out of service since the early 1990s when it was replaced. Usually, any kind of stainless steel knife will not spark flint. However, this will spark flint, so it must have some high carbon in there as well. Some people suggest that it's nickel-plated carbon. I don't think so because I've sharpened it and it stays pretty much stainless steel all the way through. However, if you pull off this handguard underneath there, you can occasionally find some rust. Now, if it was 100% stainless steel, it wouldn't rust. So if anybody has the proper answer, feel free to put it up on our site. I'd like to know as well. Now this blade is quite a bit lighter than some of the other blades that we've demonstrated. This equals about a half a bottle of water for those of you that are hikers. Now because it's light, it's a little easier to cut through the air. It's a little quicker blade, right? It can slice and dice quicker. It will thrust even quicker. The downside is because it's not heavy, you can't cudgel through something. A lot of people will buy these and they're not quite sure what to do with it. You know, they'll start hacking at bark on trees. Okay, this isn't very good for getting into firewood unless you're knocking down something like dried up blue elderberry or something like that. Now as far as a weapon, this is pretty dull. You got to sharpen it. You can sharpen it, but you got to be careful because it's a dagger, meaning it has an edge on both sides. Make sure that wherever you live it's legal to have that, or this will be confiscated. You could be fined. Now for those of us that like to do martial arts presentations in front of groups of people, this is a nice big shiny blade. If you dulled it down, knock the point down so that A, you wouldn't hurt one of your friends, and B, you wouldn't poke a hole in the wooden floor typically where you're doing your martial arts presentation with the dagger, this is pretty effective. It looks pretty cool because it's flashy, it's shiny, and it fits your hand really well. Now of course you have your standard bayonet ring right here that I threw my finger through. It's pretty hard on this particular blade to grind that off. If I really gave a damn, I would cut that off and give me a little bit more hand dexterity, because like I've said in other videos, it's really easy to start putting your thumb in there. One way to get around that is to make sure when you draw the blade that the bayonet ring is actually down on your index finger. That way your thumb doesn't try to reach for that hole, because naturally your bottom finger, your index finger, likes to grasp like a monkey does. That can alleviate some of the problems for you. Now look, I'm probably about 2.5 feet away from the camera. I can almost reach it from here, so this is deceptively long. Like we've talked about in other videos, adding a blade that's this long into my hand for offense or defense is very similar to me having the range or the reach on you with a front kick. My kick is longer than my arm, right? If you don't believe me, put a butter knife in your hand, give it a try. We have a cross guard with a muzzle ring. We have about a 4 5/8 inch black knurled handguard. I'll give you a close up. This is a black composite, which basically just means hard plastic. Even though it's smooth, you would think that if you got oil or blood or snow or ice or something on your hand that it would be slippery, but it's actually not. It's surprisingly ergonomic. A lot of people will take a little piece of sandpaper Wow, listen to those geese going overhead. They'll take a little piece of sandpaper and they'll kind of knock down some of the shine on this, which gives you a little bit more dexterity. Some people even get some boat deck tape, put it on here for a better grip. I don't need it. You probably won't need it. This works really good with gloves as well. Now, it does have a stainless steel finger guard, and it has a stainless steel locking pommel on the back. The pommel, it's really not designed for hammering things. It's really not very good for smacking somebody in the forehead. If I had to, I would. Basically, this is just something that, like in Switzerland where it's snowy all the time, probably isn't going to rust. The overall length of this blade when it is unsheathed is 14 and 5/8 inches long. That means tip to the butt. Now the blade itself is, some people say 9 and 3/8 or 9 and a half inches long, whatever. It's 9 and a half inches long, basically. Different versions, different military production runs can give you a little bit different length. As I've already stated, you can sharpen both sides of this. Be careful. And it comes to a point because it's a true dagger. This is a leftover from the fencing days. Now, this is something that was used from around 1957 to about 1990. They have since switched to a different production run, and the knife is actually very cool and very expensive. The prices and the availability of this knife used vary from $5 to $50. Use common sense when you're shopping for it. What I like about the Swiss is that they train, but they don't go to war. So when you find stuff, it's usually in perfect mint condition, sometimes just a little bit chipped up. Now your scabbard or your frog or your sheath, whatever you want to call it, comes in two versions. The older versions, closer to 1957 through the early 60s, some people say the 70s, is going to be a leather version. Leather versions are harder to find, and typically the rivets and the buttons are already gone. You'll typically find one of these nylon versions. It's got a black plastic sheath. It fits in a single throat, basically laminated vinyl or rubberized impregnated vinyl frog. And it has basically one button that secures the sheath to the frog, and then you'll have about 8 rivets that secure everything together. The belt loop is very strong. It's pretty indestructible. It's been rubberized, so if you're in a wet environment, like, you know, rainforest or in a snow belt, it's not going to fray the canvas. It's not going to start falling apart. Even when it gets really cold, it's not going to get brittle and break. Pretty indestructible, and you can find these for 50 or 60 cents at military surplus stores. Nobody messes with Switzerland. They guard all the gold. The Swiss Guard even guards the Pope. Nobody invades Switzerland because if they try to come through the tunnels get blown. The only way you're going to get into Switzerland is to parachute your way in, and you're going to have to fight your way out. And guess what? Every single person there is armed and ready to kick your butt. It sounds like a pretty good plan. They are self-reliant people. Now, they go pretty far. You know, all their building codes enforce having, nuclear, biological, and chemical facilities built into them. Whether it's that or whether it's for radiation, every house or every building is set up to where, in the event of World War III, those people are taken care of. Now, I don't endorse that for the United States. I think you can go off the deep end and start building bunkers, and you can start getting scared. That's what happened in the 50s and early 60s, and it's not really necessary. But the principle that I do like is that everybody's trained, everybody's prepared to fight for their own country and help their military be stronger door-to-door, shore-to-shore, and that's what we should do here. Now, if you don't want to be part of the Swiss Armed Forces, or for whatever reason you don't qualify, what happens is you're assigned about a 3% additional tax until you're 30 years old. You're kind of paying to opt out. See anything wrong with that? The Swiss government trusts its people. They give them their arms. They give them their training. They even keep these fully automatic machine guns and ammo at home. And they keep their gear at home. In closing, Grassroots Civil Defense is on the march. Won't you join us?